today's session, but I heard some rave reviews about the amazing speakers and some thought-provoking discussions we've had so far. And I'd like to thank the ECA to give me this opportunity to come here and share with you some learnings that we've had at Nehru World School. I will be sharing with you some thoughts and our experiences of the power of play or play-based learning. I understand that yesterday's conference started by inauguration of this play policy. So heartiest congratulations to ECA, because this was very much needed.
And we missed you during the launch.
So did I. Now, we understand that play is versatile, and it can mean many different things to different people, different things to different teachers, and very different things to different children. And we as educators are conscious of this. Play can take on many forms, a few of which are mentioned up there, but looking at the document, I saw that you've listed 26 different types of play. And that is so empowering for us as educators, because there is so much we can play around with and work with and use in our classroom. Often, while talking to teachers, I understand that there is no denying that play is extremely imperative in the early childhood years for linguistic, cognitive, social, emotional development. But the educators, the practitioners in the classrooms, are facing some serious struggles. Where do I find time? I need to teach all the letter sounds and blend words by the end of the year? That takes time. Have you heard that?
Oh yeah.
Yeah? How much play? We do have sports and yoga in our timetable. Is that truly what play is? Where will they play? Indoors or outdoors? Will all 30 children in my classroom play together? Really, at the same time? Can you imagine the chaos? And finally, how will I show that play is leading to learning? How will I show that to my parent? In the words of Lisa De Wood, it is the tug of war between meeting mandated academic standards and honoring developmentally age-appropriate practice of play that affects the practitioner in the classroom. We have outcomes that we understand we need to achieve, and we have play, which we know that children, that is pedagogically the best way in which children can learn. What do we do? What do we focus on? What is the key to the problem? Probably understanding that play and learning are not antithetical, but integrally connected. They are the same thing. They can lead to the same thing. And I personally feel at NWS, at Healthy Planet, which is our early childhood wing, what has really helped us is a form of guided play, which we feel has been a very powerful tool in the hands of our teachers. It's a form of play where children explore within an environment that is created by adults, in which adults may or may not scaffold or support the children's play. We can choose to have certain activities or certain aspects which would be absolutely child-led, and some could be child-led but adult-supported. Where there is a learning goal in mind, for sure, guided play trumps over free play in achieving learning outcomes. In no way am I putting down the value and power of free play, pretend play, or free choice, because that is something which is also built into our daily rhythms and routines at Healthy Planet. But we feel, particularly with respect to achieving certain learning outcomes, guided play has come in very handy. I would like to share with you an initiative that we started at Nehru World School about 10 months back. It's called the Busy Bags Initiative, And before I get into the details of what we're doing in school, I'd like to give you a little bit of context on where we are. We are a small school of about 1,500 children in a city called Ghaziabad, which is in the National Capital Region. It takes us about 40, 45 minutes on a good day to get to Ghaziabad from central Delhi. We have an energetic student population. Our early childhood wing has children from 2 to 5 years of age. We have about 200 children. So we have a pre-nursery, nursery and kindergarten, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5 year olds, and about 3 sections each. Our teachers are a very enthusiastic bunch. They're young, they're ready to try out new things. They really care for the children, just like all of us here do. That's why we're sitting here. So we felt about sometime around this time last year, we felt we needed to do more in our classrooms to bring more play-based learning into the classroom, but we wanted to do it in a scalable manner, something that could be easily achievable and children would enjoy. So we came up with the ideas of creating busy bags. Now these busy bags essentially were created for all children from 2 to 5 years. And they addressed learning outcomes to promote literacy, numeracy, fine motor development, and creative thinking and expression. These are some samples of them. They were just simple Ziploc bags, which would have some teaching resources that the teachers created, which would help support learning outcomes in these different areas. While the literacy and numeracy outcomes and activities were with a defined purpose, we kept the fine motor activities and creative expression and thinking activities very open-ended to create the right balance. Now these busy bags were modeled by the teachers once, either through small group presentations or whole class presentations. The children created some ground rules on using these busy bags, taking turns, using the material respectfully, etc., etc., just responsible behavior. These busy bags were offered throughout the day in the sense that they were placed in the classroom and children were offered opportunities to use them, particularly during transition times, post-lunch breaks, etc. They were free to choose which bags they wanted to play and learn with. The teachers, in turn, observed children's interest areas, looked at the kind of activities they were working on, and scaffolded their learning as and when required. The observations were demonstrated and documented as anecdotal records and photographs. Now, as mentioned earlier, these were guided by specific learning outcomes in literacy and numeracy. They were also leveled activities for each learning outcome. So there were usually 3 leveled activities. The academic activities in literacy and numeracy were balanced with creative expression. We tried and incorporated integrated learning as much as possible. And this was primarily aimed at allowing the child to take ownership of his or her own learning. We used a lot of manipulative, sensory-rich material, a lot of recycled material, a lot of reusable material to keep it environment-friendly, at the same time sensorially rich for the child to experience. After 3 months, we reviewed this program, and this is what the teachers observed. They felt that the children were purposely engaged, particularly during transitions. Have you in the classroom ever noticed that sometimes children wish to spend a little more time on a particular task, or they need to spend a little more time on a particular task, and we rush them just because we do not want the other children in the class to probably just be sitting idle? Now this came in very handy around those times wherein children were given a little more freedom to stick around with what they wanted to do or they needed to do while the others were purposefully engaged. It also provided more challenge for the children who were ready to take the next step because the activities were leveled. For the same learning outcome, there were activities on 3 levels. So the ones who needed a little more challenge could take on the activities which were of a higher level. As a class resource, they were new, fun, playful, and they motivated children to be able to speed up, to be able to access them as and when they wanted. Some of them even offered opportunities for pair learning and small group learning. They were useful in reinforcing concepts. They had potential to be modified into individualizing learning for the children as well. And the creative thinking and expression busy bags were in fact the most popular one. And these were the ones which were more open-ended. So that was a direct feedback to us as educators that children were actually more engaged in open-ended activities vis-a-vis those that required them to do a specific task. So that is a feedback that came to us through this activity as well. Now we wanted to go a step further and see how we could improve this even more. So at that time, the entire school was going through a wave of differentiated learning and how to create more differentiated learning plans and goals for our children, not just in the early years, but in the primary and the middle school as well. So the teachers, along with our head teacher in the pre-primary, came up with the idea of incorporating differentiated learning through individualized plans to use these busy bags. So in phase B, we actually created individualized learning plans, keeping in mind the child's needs and interests. However, these plans, though were created by the teachers and shared with the children were allowed to take ownership of their own learning. They were in no way forced on children. While it was suggested that these could be helpful, the children were still offered freedom to choose what they wanted to while having that information. So we felt that this also had some unanticipated outcomes, which were very welcome. In this image, you would see a little girl working with a creative thinking and expression busy bag. We call them invitations to create. So here, it was an invitation to create a new creature out of her imagination. And you would see it's leading to pretend play. So how one form of play very easily led to this, and then this involved other children joining in and having a cooperative group play session as well. So we feel that guided play in this way has helped us preserve the joy of learning and child-directedness of play while supporting children as they progressed towards their learning goals. Thus, in a way, it offers a balanced middle ground between traditional direct instruction and absolute free play, which I understand some of us might not be able to give a lot of time to currently in our systems. So it offered a very balanced middle ground between the two. Now, in our opinion, this is the need of the hour. We do need to develop a strong curricular program while endorsing a playful pedagogy, and I'm really hopeful this will guide us in the right direction. Thank you so much. We also need to invest in playful learning that includes both free play and guided play. And we need to create learning environments that are active, engaging, meaningful, and socially interactive. I feel that would go a long, long, long way in helping us achieve our goals. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Singh, for giving us